Hello everyone, welcome to another Sadge review. The source of today's review is Avatar The Last Airbender live action.
My name is Aang. And I'm the Avatar.
Nope, not that live action. This time it seems they made it into a show, so we're gonna see how it is and decide whether or not it's good. So without further ado, here is...
The Avatar.
This first scene does an exceptional job at telling us where we are and what's happening, with the choreography not being bad at all. The CGI has come a long way in 13 years, and the bending is pretty cool. Not to mention, we also get some insight on the plan Sozin put into play after Avatar Roku died.
Because it is our time.
I would think that seeing someone burned alive from a story based on a kid's show would make it clear that they're trying to age the story up, make it for more mature audiences, but we'll see where it goes.
Hey!
So are they just making it so Aang can fly now? I thought that was the whole point of his glider, or Appa.
Now, you and the other students better go help set up for the Great Comet Festival. There's still a lot of work to be done before the air nomads from the other temples arrive.
How many are coming?
All of them.
So I didn't notice this the first time watching, but Monk Gyatso confirms that every monk from any other air temple is at the Southern Air Temple for the Comet Festival. And I'm not saying that it's wrong, but the fact that four air temples worth of air nomads, except for one, were genocided in one night is insane.
The world needs the Avatar. The world needs you, Aang. You're to leave right away so you can begin training in the other disciplines.
Right away? Leave my friends? Leave home? Leave you?
In the OG Avatar The Last Airbender, Aang mentions his reluctance to leave the Air Temple and his teacher, Monk Gyatso. But in The Legend of Korra, Korra trains and masters her first three elements with what I can only assume are her masters to those corresponding elements. So it seems that this is something that Aang changed about Avatar training after he defeated Lord Ozai. But that would be giving props to Legend of Korra, which is something I won't do.
But you're not just anyone, Aang. You're strong. And kind. And generous. Remember that.
This is where I get aggravated with entertainment. When a storyteller decides they'd rather have a supporting character say these are a character's traits and virtues without the character actively showing any evidence whatsoever of these virtues or traits, it makes no sense to someone who has no idea who Aang is, and we've known him for less time than I can keep my goldfish alive. So show us, don't tell us.
So says I'm supposed to be the Avatar. Don't even trust me to feed the baby bison, and I'm supposed to save the world. He said, I need to remember who I am. But I know who I am. I like to play air ball and eat banana cakes and goof off with my friends. That's who I am.
Then please, for the love of God, show that.
I don't want to leave. I don't want the responsibility. I'm scared of my power. I'm scared of being alone.
It's almost as if the director or story writer said, hey, instead of showing the kind of kid Aang is during his time at the Air Temple, let's just have him and other characters describe him for you.
I know who I am.
Aang is powerful.
I mean, it's almost as if they're treating the viewer like they're blind. Might as well just give me his obituary and I'll learn everything I need to know about him. Hey, you want to convey to me that Aang is scared? Hey, he'll just tell me himself.
I'm scared of being alone.
Want to convey to me that he can't play with other airbenders because he's possibly too strong? He'll just tell me himself.
I'm scared of my power up.
Want to show me that he's feeling overburdened by the new expectations of him being the Avatar? Oh, you'll just tell me that he's feeling overwhelmed.
I don't want the responsibility.
Pretty sure you're not supposed to be reading out the characteristics of the person you're trying to be portraying as. Anyways, moving on. I want to say that the CGI and the choreography are strong points of this show so far, and that's a big deal when some people think that having live-action show adaptations just won't do the animated show justice. Especially when it comes to combat or gymnastics. So whether it's the special effects team, or the hiring team finding people for the project that actually want to display a decent battle, it really makes some of Disney's properties get blown out of water in comparison.
Rosero Dawson.
Alright, but all that aside, they really did my man Monkey Yatso dirty by robbing him of his last stand. Like, imagine getting the IP of Avatar Last Airbender after 20 years of fan speculation on how he must have locked all the air out of the room, suffocating the firebenders inside as well as himself, and then you just don't do it.
You may have prevailed on another night. But not when we have the power of the comet.
I really think this is a cool portrayal of Fire Lord Sozin, but really how much does a comet strengthen firebenders? Isn't the sun a giant factor into the power of firebenders? How much exactly does it benefit to attack at night when you aren't buffed by the sun? Moving on. Now knowing what the show is capable of special effects wise, there's a few instances of green screen that really look off. Especially when they start using Appa for some reason, they keep blurring the background and focusing on the people, then unblurring the background, and it really gives me a headache. These kids at the South Pole walk past Aang like he's not the weirdest looking foreigner in the world. Now, I'm going to be picky throughout this, and I would feel bad if I didn't know that a reported at least $15 million was spent on each separate episode of this season. So the ADR automated dialogue replacement that they had to have at 4203, where Katara says,
"Those who can't protect themselves. He's lost everything he knows."
Just feels a little unprofessional for a multi-$100 million project that, I'll just be honest and call it up for what it is an expensive agenda-pushing cash grab that does not respect the original story nor the characters, even though they say that they do. Netflix sure has a weird way of showing respect to the original creators when they give them the choice between changing the show from the original or leaving the project entirely. Anyways, back to the show. Sokka doesn't use a boomerang at all in this fight, and honestly, it's a wasted opportunity because there's a lot of things in this show that try to be funny that simply aren't.
So the drive to conquer is a drive for peace. And unity.
But peace comes from respecting life, not killing and destroying.
A noble sentiment, Avatar. But in the end, for most of us, it doesn't matter how this war started. It only matters how it can end. And the belief is that by capturing you, the Fire Nation can finally bring that about.
Is that what you believe?
I must leave.
They're making it seem as if Uncle Iroh is conflicted rather than already determined on his peaceful way of life. Weird creative choice. Not sure how I feel about it. Well, why doesn't he just do what he did earlier and he wouldn't need his glider? Well, that was episode 1, and it only took a full day of editing, and it ended up being 9 minutes long, roughly, so... Wait, hold on a moment. I was thinking this the entire time I was watching episode 1, but I didn't believe that it was true, so I had to go back and rewatch. Katara never even actually introduces herself to Aang on screen. I think the only person that Aang introduces himself to is Sokka. And the kids, I guess, that are around him at that time. But yeah, no, Katara never even introduces herself to Aang, it's crazy. Aang might know Sokka's name from overhearing Katara call out to him when he's calling out for Appa, but legitimately there was no introduction between Katara and Aang. So this show is skipping a lot. Wow. I don't know what to say, really. Alright, now we're going to the next episode. They made Momo hyper-realistic just like that cursed first iteration of the Sonic movie. Except when we bully this production because they're abusing our childhood shows, they'll just make another one. Anyways.
Somebody needs to put a bell on you.
There's food in the village hall.
Why did they make Suki a pervert? Suki watches Sokka with no shirt and nobody gets hurt. But if Sokka was watching Suki and there's no shirt on Suki, he'd be in deep dookie. More disappointingly obvious ADR.
I never wanted to fight. And I'm afraid of hurting someone.
Hey. It's about time.
I'm sorry. I didn't know how to reach you. I didn't know I could reach you.
There's a lot you don't know.
Well, there's a lot that this show isn't even gonna touch on, so I don't think you're missing much, Aang.
Can we go any faster?
We're at top speed. Everything that can be done is being done. You've waited 3 years. You can wait a little longer.
Three years. There were times I thought I'd never find the Avatar.
God damn it. For as many bodies that I've seen burnt in this series that would lead me to believe that it's made for adults, the director just treats us like children. God forbid we have a moment of silence to maybe as the viewer interpret for ourselves how being thrown out of our home might feel and have the only chance at returning slipping through our fingers. Zuko should be furious right now. He should be threatening this crew to be burned alive if Zhao gets to the Avatar first. He should be livid at Zhao's betrayal, but instead he gets emotional, which isn't out of character for Zuko, but misplaced this moment in time where he has little to zero control over his future, and instead of going into a fiery rage, he almost cries? Does that really sound like season 1 Zuko character to you?
The Fire Nation's greatest threat is just a little kid.
That kid, Uncle, just did this. I won't underestimate him again. Dig the ship out and follow them!
And the thing is that besides maybe Sokka, this actor is the most like their corresponding character from the OG show. So if they're screwing up one of the most intriguing, deep, and meaningful character arcs of possibly any animated show ever, my hopes aren't that high for the lesser cared for characters. Nonetheless, moving on. I'm a bit confused how Avatar Kyoshi knows the future, especially since the Fire Nation only attacks the North Pole because Aang and his friends are headed there. But besides that, I love how she's represented, maybe show off a bit more earthbending the next time since that was her original element. But yeah, really cool. Man, if they're gonna ADR something in, I'd at least hope that it has substance or it's important.
Zuko clearly isn't going to give up, and he's dangerous.
Yes, it's pretty obvious that Zuko is not gonna give up.
3 years. 3 years.
Do we have any evidence of him being dangerous to Aang? No, not really. Dangerous to Sokka? Yeah.
Kyoshi said I can only call upon one of the past avatars when I'm in their shrines.
No, the hell she didn't. At least not when we were watching. And if the directors are adding rules to communicating with past avatars and don't even show them exposit those rules on camera, they better at least follow them.
What else did she tell you? We need to get to the Northern Water Tribe, because something terrible is going to happen there. Something only I can stop.
The waterbending masters there are the best in the world. They can train you.
Remember this line later on. Anyways, that's the end of episode 2. Starting on episode 3, we have the false aspect of suspense, which is really just Azula's live-action introduction. And I say false suspense because obviously the Fire Lord won't be assassinated on the third episode, and we still have at least 2 more seasons to crank out. That being said, I don't think Azula is bratty enough. In the OG show, she is absolutely subservient to her father, and would probably shout out in defense of him being disrespected by what she would consider to be worms. Peasants living prosperous lives under the Fire Nation's rule. I do like the rage that she's failing to hide. Showing us, not telling us, that even though she just exposed an assassination attempt on her father's life, that her achievement is swept aside by her brother Zuko's achievement of finding the Avatar. Next.
I don't get it. Basic bending forms are mostly just physical movement. But when you get into the harder moves, like the water whip, you really need to reach inside and feel the energy flow.
Why is Aang giving Katara pointers on waterbending? Isn't she supposed to be teaching Aang? Yes, Aang doesn't want to train in waterbending because his last teacher was Monk Gyatso and he's not really gotten over his death yet.
But avoiding practice doesn't mean you avoid the responsibility. I know. It's just...
Katara training Aang wasn't just for him to learn waterbending, it was also to better know Katara, for both of them to bond, for Aang to gain confidence, and also, even at some points, raise tension to the point of conflict.
The monks always told us to find a place where emotion meets spirit, a place deeper than thought. Tap into your feelings and gather energy from them.
What? Just to get this straight, we have the peaceful nomad monks, whose bending were mostly in defensive arts, told you to tap in your feelings and gather energy from them. Most zen, most peaceful, most disciplined benders told you to use your feelings for power, and you think this will apply to a whole new elemental bending technique that you haven't even started to learn yet? Well, let me just make this clear. The only thing that would have been more nonsensical than this is if this actually helped Katara bend. Moving on. Cabbage Man fan service. Because when the Netflix adaptation can't come up with anything new and creative that makes sense, go back to old reliable. So this firebender guy whose clothing gets hit by Longshot just stays here. Nobody goes over to knock him out or anything. Then we're introduced to Jet's not very organic freedom fighters.
Awesome shooting there, Longshot. That was a mean swing, Pipsqueak. Nice switch. I had a feeling you knew how to handle yourself.
Really? Cool attack on that flame head. Thanks,
Pipsqueak. He's the dude. I'm Pipsqueak.
It's great to have a water bender on our side.
In the original, Smellerbee was boisterous and standoffish, which makes sense for someone in their position. But here, she's completely robbed of her character, and all of the pity that we should be feeling for her and all the other freedom fighters is dogpiled on the Jet's character.
When the Fire Nation came to our village, she held them off. Well, my dad had been unwell.
I understand that they might have just won a very small victory against the Fire Nation spies in Omashu, but they're acting like this win healed them from all the pain of losing their brothers, sisters, mothers, and fathers. These kids that have had almost everything taken from them, hunted by the Fire Nation their entire lives, welcome an outsider who they know close to nothing about with open arms? I'm not sure. Katara is a dick for wasting this primitive camp's small source of clean drinking water when there's a stream literally right beside her. Zuko is as confused as I am right now when we get Uncle Iroh offering himself up for no reason, because I guess having him get captured while soaking naked in a hot tub would be too adult for this adult kid show. Anyways, that wraps up everything wrong with episode 3, let's now move on to episode 4.
Where are you taking him?
To the pit.
The pit?
An Earth Kingdom labor camp for prisoners of war. No one who's been sent there has ever been heard from again.
Thank you, narrative Uncle Iroh.
Lotus root, pine bark, dried jasmine, scalding hot water, steep for 2 minutes!
Even if you count the time at the start of the command he was given, the royal palace servant did not steep the tea for 2 minutes. Even if you do count the seconds that it takes for King Bumi to spit the tea out, it would only be roughly 60 seconds. Since when did Katara ever learn or show any ability of physical defense? Since when did Katara ever learn how to bend like this? The show is tacking on attributes to the main characters without demonstrating practice or showing a reason why they would be capable of these skills they possess in the first place. The only bending that we have ever seen Katara do is water, not ice. I'm confused with what the show thinks the viewer knows. Like, yeah, I know that most waterbenders can make ice, but for the new people where this is their first experience with Avatar, won't know that. And for a show that's been coddling viewers, I sure as heck don't know why they don't show Katara waterbending ice till now. So many shows, just like this one, play to the viewer to make sense of their dysfunctional story, but when the viewer actually tries to do so, the show keeps contradicting itself. Speaking of impeccable storytelling, why does Jet want to kill the king of Omashu?
This is our chance to burn out this city's diseased heart.
Killing the mechanist makes sense. He's a traitor, and despite his reasoning, he's making equipment and machinery for the Fire Nation. But there's no evidence as to why Jet would think that the king is corrupt. Why would killing the mechanist and the king suddenly make all the Fire Nation spies show their faces? In the original story, Jet deems killing innocent Fire Nation civilians as a required sacrifice to rid their land of the Fire Nation.
To rid the valley of the Fire Nation. There are people living there, Jet. Mothers and fathers and children. We can't win without making some sacrifices.
Which might be cynical and evil, but it's pretty accurate to the ideology of some recent military commanders. In fact, killing the king of Omashu, if anything, could throw this Earth Kingdom into such disarray that they would be even easier to siege, infiltrate, and conquer. So not only is the remixed version of Jet evil, he's yet another part of the show that doesn't follow any sense or logic. Moving on. We have time for this janky remix secret tunnel because a CGI fight between Aang and King Bumi's pet would break the bank for this episode.
It's a path.
It said love is brightest in the dark, not glowy rocks.
Poetic license, like the minstrel said. Love is the answer. Love is all you need. Love makes the world go round.
Now you're listening to the minstrels? Sokka, wait!
Katara, what is your problem?
My problem is you're not taking me seriously.
Listen.
I'm not a little girl anymore.
Yet you keep acting like one.
And you keep acting like you know everything when you couldn't even tell that a traitor was flat out lying to you.
Says the girl who fell for a terrorist.
That's not what happened.
You should have never talked to him.
You don't get to tell me who I can talk to.
And you don't get to just ignore me.
I can't if you're being an idiot.
Dad put me in
trouble. You're not dad.
They have completely destroyed Katara's character. This whole fight starts because even though Katara is the one holding the map, she questions Sokka's confidence in navigating the cavern. So instead of coming up with a better idea of how to navigate through the system of tunnels, she continues to disagree with Sokka's method, telling him that his judgment is faulty due to not realizing that the mechanist was a Fire Nation spy sooner. Which is odd for Katara to bring up because back in episode 3 she pleaded to Sokka to
shut up and gloat later. Right now we need to stop Sai. Jet planted a bomb on him.
because his judgment of Jet's character was right. This whole argument doesn't remotely make sense between these two, because Katara argues that she isn't taken seriously by her brother when all of the effort she has provided in this endeavor is questioning Sokka's abilities in navigating a judgment of character, while not giving any reasonable idea of her own to try. Aren't they supposed to be trying to save Aang right now? I'm glad we have over a minute for this rush show to have Katara's husk of a character make up with Sokka over an argument that made no sense in the first place.
Oh, it's true, isn't it? You have no humanity. You know nothing of loss.
I like the show wants to try to be dull enough to talk about the casualties of war, but I can't take it seriously because it was common knowledge that Iroh only stopped his siege of Ba Sing Se because his only son had died. So what's put in here as a cool, humanizing piece just reminds me how little the writers care about paying homage to the story and to the characters. Also, this guard wastes food and water he could be giving to the kids of the Earth Kingdom, but instead he'd rather litter the road to show how much he hates this guy.
When my studies weren't going well and father was unhappy, Lieutenant gave me this. He'd won it for finishing first in his officer class. He said it should belong to someone destined to do great things. It gave me strength. Lieutenant never needed it because he was the strongest person I knew.
What a beautiful scene. Great elements, dialogue, acting, and cinematography. If this scene was by itself, I would go out of my way to sing praises of this show. But these beautiful pieces are surrounded by failure and such wasted potential that not even this and the rare scenes like this one can redeem the series. Anyways, moving on.
Sokka, what I said about you and Dad.
Forget it.
You led the tribe and protected us with nobody to help you. Dad never had to bear that kind of burden alone. You had it harder than him.
I kind of wish that Sokka talked about his mom. It only ever mentions his relationship with his dad and how much his approval means to him, but Sokka lost his mother too, and we're never shown the toll it took on him. It only ever has him consoling Katara about their mom, and never vice versa.
You versus me. To the death.
We could have had absolutely ripped CGI Boomy, or just let the makeup and prosthetic team do their thing. What a waste. I understand the message Boomy is trying to get through to Aang about being the Avatar, but why is Aang still here? Not only did he help save the king, but he also helped rid it of some of its Fire Nation spies. So what exactly is Aang still doing here? Talking to an old friend that's actively trying to kill him? Aang could just leave, find Sokka and Katara, and then continue their trip to the North Pole. In the original fight with King Boomy, Katara and Sokka are both trapped in that rock candy and their lives being in jeopardy is what causes Aang to continue playing his games. But they aren't even here. So, just leave. And that's pretty much everything from episode 4. Moving on to episode 5. We get more prime examples of weird looking green screen while they ride Appa.
Your bending has gotten really sharp. I mean, you've been inventing new moves. That's a mark of a skilled bender.
Yeah, Katara has learned a lot from Grand Grand's one scroll. Definitely shouldn't have had an episode where they steal scrolls from pirates or something stupid like that. Yeah, something where Katara and Aang fight because she did something immoral and has to reconcile with her choices, occasionally getting the group in danger. You know what? Nah, that episode sounds stupid.
We've been running into the firebenders a lot more often.
We're getting closer to the Fire Nation border. It was bound to happen. Even without Sokka's tragic dating attempts.
Hey, how was I supposed to know she was a Fire Nation soldier?
Sokka's gonna have more love interest in season 1 than the entirety of the original show.
My name's Sokka. Rhymes with Akka and Waka Waka.
Did Sokka somehow watch the Muppets down in the South Pole?
Waka Waka!
Something beyond this world.
You're right. The people are beyond this world. But I can get them back.
So just because Aang is the Avatar means that he has a spidey sense for all things delving into the spirit world, he doesn't need to talk to past Avatars to know how to do any of this? I want to know how much info is just out and about on being the Avatar, especially since he hasn't been seen in over 100 years. That and Aang never received training from the Airbenders on being the Avatar since he didn't know until they were turned into air-fried chicken. We get zero explanation as to how Aang knows any of this. The writers are aware of this plot hole, so they have Sokka question Aang's confidence in his dubious ability just to be ignored while trying to get the viewer to forget about the reasoning with a bad gag.
I need to find where the spiritual energy is strongest.
And where's that?
I don't want to find it.
You almost said something specific.
While simultaneously making fun of anyone trying to make sense of this incoherent logic.
You sounded a lot more confident before.
Because all of this is my responsibility. Yes, I need to get to the north so I can save the waterbenders. But I also need to help these people so they don't lose their homes and the ones they love. The way I lost mine.
We get a great line of dialogue when Sokka basically questions Aang how competent he is with things pertaining to spirits. And Aang replies with something along the lines of, "It's my responsibility as Avatar. I can't have these people's homes be destroyed like mine once was. So what I'm going to do about it is help this small shantytown instead of hurrying to the North Pole where thousands are going to lose their homes to the Fire Nation." Which doesn't really answer Sokka's original question about, you know, his experience with spirits, but it's fine. Who needs to learn how to deal with things when being responsible automatically makes you qualified to handle whatever the spirit world has to throw at you? Moving on. Well, before we actually move on, quick recap on our main characters. Even though it was only talked about and resolved over 3 episodes, which seemed like maybe 2 days long story-wise, Aang finally finishes his What If I Hurt Someone arc and starts his I Am the Avatar Here to Help arc, and it feels really fake and forced because the confidence comes from nowhere. The writers save so much time and money talking about the traits of the main character over showing them that it feels like I'm reading the story from a third-hand source. Besides starting fights over nothing, Katara's character feels emotionless even though she's been non-stop thinking and talking about how her mom was burned alive in front of her. The character has been robbed so much so far that they haven't even had her introduce herself to Aang at all. Which is a weird way to start off the dynamic of someone who's eventually supposed to not only be Aang's waterbending teacher but also his love interest. And the news coming out that they are, and I quote, "cutting Sokka's sexism because it had no place in the remake told me everything I needed to know about how hollow his transformation into a skilled warrior, engineer, and eventually battle tactician would end up." Instead of angry, angsty Zuko, who isn't that talented at bending, we get crybaby Zuko, who was apparently skilled enough when he was 13 to not only hold his own in a fight against his father, the Fire Lord, but would have got a shot off on him. Oh, my bad, that's an episode 6 spoiler. So God, if he truly does exist, only knows what the plan for this character arc is. Even Uncle Iroh doesn't seem to be the jolly, wise, happy old man that spoke in pie show metaphors half the time that we all know and love, and is instead a sidekick character to Zuko that instead of advising, listens to what his nephew orders. Alright, actually, moving on.
But what is happening?
I don't know. I've separated my spirit from my body, but somehow I brought you guys with me.
How is that possible?
If you guys ever wanted to hear a story writer shit on an explanation before due to an adaptation to the original story, this is what it would sound like.
Must be the energies in the place and thinness up the barrier in my power. So much pain.
Remember this. If I see Katara relive her mother being incinerated one more time, I'm gonna have PTSD from her PTSD.
The truth is, not everyone is meant to have people's lives in their hands.
Yay, another water tribe family trauma. Come on, Sokka, be a man. You didn't even see your mother burn to death.
Your friends? Now why would I let you play with my food?
You know I love me some story changing, especially when it's at the detriment of the story. On second thought, I'm going to save Ko for next episode.
Once I save my friends, what more time?
Time. Time is a funny thing. The past, the future, it all gets mixed up.
Time gets all mixed up when you have a storyline and end up skipping 2/3 of it to leech off a wonderful and original IP. That sums up everything for episode 5, now time for episode 6.
Are you seriously going to let this spineless slug tell us what to do? He doesn't know what's at stake! We can't let him come in and take it all away, not after everything we've been through.
Why did they make Zuko such a crybaby? Especially in front of his crew. Him crying about all that we've been through makes no sense even if he was nicer to his crew. They're soldiers of the Fire Nation, under your leadership. Even if they did assist in catching the Avatar, they'll just be under someone else's command when your banishment is lifted. The only time Zuko would ever show humanity was especially not around his crew, but only to his uncle in solidarity.
Loyalty. General, with all due respect, your nephew doesn't know the meaning of the word. If he did, he would have shown us, the people who've been with him, 9 days for 3 years, a lot more respect. Instead, we've had to put up with his insults and abuse and tantrums.
He doesn't care what we've had to sacrifice, because he's never had to sacrifice anything. If you ask anyone here, they'll tell you he may be a prince, but he's not our prince.
As cool as this argument is, the only time Iroh would ever fight Zuko's battles for him is if he was about to be struck by lightning. Iroh's only purpose after losing his son was to help Zuko find his own path. Try to help him perceive what is important in his life. Teach him how to think for himself. Determine who his family really is. Not defend Zuko's honor from a bunch of Fire Nation soldiers.
Who dares disturb the peace of the Avatar? Is it not customary to bow before your elders? And to avert your eyes and hop on one leg? Forgive me, I couldn't resist. Yoshi has always been kind of...
I thought you'd all be like that.
What the f***? They really just made Roku the goofy avatar? The guy whose last moments were him being betrayed by his lifelong friend and left to die in a fog? The avatar who died knowing that the lack of his presence was reason for the Fire Nation to start what has become a brutal 100-year war? I want to know who on this project looked at this guy's character's rap sheet and said, yeah, we can get some laughs out of him. I'm really glad we ruined Roku's character just because Aang needed a bartering item to get his friends back from Ko. And since we're back on Ko, who apparently only steals faces and eats people when the story needs him to. Not only that, but for some reason Ko can't make the Avatar relive their past failure or despair, as he calls it. If anything, Aang is maybe the most bothered by their truth of having 100 years of war rage on due to his disappearance. So the only explanation is that the Avatars are now immune. Whereas in the original, if he were to show any emotion, his face would be stolen. So Ko, the face-stealing spirit centipede that feeds out the worst memories of things in the spirit world, has a mother, and she's a spirit, but she's a totem whose existence created individuality. So we need to return her to Ko, or else Aang's friends will be eaten. Thank God we tried to cram episodes 7, 8, 12, 13, and 20 from book 1 into this remix mess of an episode. I won't even bring up, you know what, I will bring up the fact that there's no explained reason as to why Roku stole Ko's mom from him to begin with, but thank God he did, or else Sokka and what's-her-name with no character would have been eaten. Moving on to more nonsense. We get this magnificent scene where Ozai explicitly requests for Zuko to speak his mind. Then when he does...
It's a terrible plan.
He's forced to an Agni Kai. Imagine being given permission to speak freely and then in return you are forced into a duel, then scarred for life. Yeah, sure, Ozai wants to know if his son has the mind of a war tactician. In the original, Zuko was never called upon. He spoke out of turn and as a result of this embarrassment was forced into an Agni Kai with his father, the Fire Lord. Now Zuko, knowing he'd get his ass handed to him, begged and groveled for forgiveness, resulting in him being maimed and banished. Here we have Zuko being asked his choice of strategy. Zuko remarks how blatantly disregarding their own Fire Nation soldiers' lives for an opportunity at winning a battle was unbecoming of a Fire Nation officer. Then Zuko being forced into an Agni Kai with his father. And like I said earlier, at 13 not only stands his ground with his father, but pretty much would have gotten a hit off on the Fire Lord. Now how would that look for the Fire Lord to maybe not be bested, but to even be hurt at all by a boy a quarter of his age, not only in front of his family, but in front of all of the Fire Nation generals, officers, and admirals? I would say that it'd make the Fire Lord look old and weak, and Zuko's restraint or compassion is the only thing keeping Ozai from being overthrown in this nation where leadership is determined by strength. Glad with all these changes, we found room to also make Lord Ozai's decisions look unintelligent. Well, at least he's a less important character. He's only the end boss of the entire show in Aang's final test. Back to more pain and suffering. The show somehow finds time for Zhao to brag about Aang being completely secure with no way of escape, yet fails to confiscate the weird spirit totem pole thing from him. Aang spends what feels like one third of the episode persuading people to release him so he can save his friends. Yet as soon as he's freed, he decides it's a better use of time to sit and have a talk with Zuko, the guy who's been hunting him since he popped out of the ice ball. Forget about Aang not asking Zuko why he freed him. He sits and has a chat with him for all the time while his friends that he put in danger could be co-food right now. Even when they try and be original and give us the hypothetical where they sit and talk, they made the exact situation where sitting and talking was the worst thing for the scene. And don't get me started on, well, actually, they can't get to the boat because there's patrols. That's f***ing bullshit. Aang gets knocked out Zuko back to the boat no prom, and then he proceeds to fly the f*** off after, yes, wasting more time talking to Zuko. Speaking of Zuko, why is Aang talking to him or anyone about what he wants versus expected of you? Aang ran away from his responsibilities for 5 minutes and it might have saved his life, but his disappearance had a war rage on for 100 years. Not only does it not make sense for Aang to give Zuko that advice, Iroh should be the one giving it to him. Oh, well, I guess fuck Iroh, he doesn't need to be here. Aang doesn't need Katara to teach him waterbending, we don't need Iroh to teach Zuko anything, the 12-year-old monk that likes banana cake and goofing off with his friends allegedly can do it. I don't even hate the backstory that they made between Zuko and the 41st, but since it's surrounded by garbage, by association, it's garbage. Anyways, that's it for episode 6, I guess I guess we're moving on. Yeah, I guess that's what we're doing now. All right, let's do this. Episode 7. So Katara, the husk of a shell of a character that they made her to be, is now just a girl who has no sense of character judgment. Because nobody in their right mind would think that the guy who has tried to burn down their village, chase them across the globe, make them relive their burning mom PTSD, shoot fire directly at them, is simply misunderstood and worthy of building connections with. So instead of pissed off Katara and Sokka that are deservingly mad that Aang even believes that Zuko's redeemable after he's attempted killing all of them, we get Katara, who probably has a crush on Zuko, and Sokka, who's like, yeah, I wasn't about to be turned into cooked Eskimo episode 1.
This whole time, I've been worried that I don't know what I'm doing. And the truth is, I don't. I haven't learned any of the other bending skills, and I'll probably continue messing up. But at least I'll be able to do it with my friends by my side. That's right. Team Avatar.
This is the most awkward, fake, unearned scene I've possibly watched so far. Aang being genuinely satisfied with not learning any new forms of bending when he has to take on the Fire Nation and continuously messing up as long as he has companionship is absolutely bonkers. It's complete opposite of how he was just acting with Katara and Sokka back at the Southern Air Temple, saying, I must fill my duty as Avatar to not waste the sacrifice my friends of the Southern Air Temple made. Two, it's okay if I fail as long as I'm failing and not fulfilling my duty with my friends. In the original animated show, Aang constantly struggled with the idea of him being the one chance the entire world had at peace, and whenever he was stressed out from the idea of mastering all four elements and defeating the Fire Lord, that is when his friends would be there to help him, because he was actually trying to learn water. He was trying to find an earthbending teacher. He didn't just go around not trying to learn, attempting to help people while not having any idea how to do so.
What about getting to the north? Didn't Kiyoshi tell you you had to get there to prevent a tragedy?
I've seen such a lack of urgency and determination to even attempt learning waterbending that if the studio wasn't getting so caught up in making Katara's trauma her personality, she'd have a better shot at defeating the Fire Lord after 3 seasons. Especially at this rate, if she keeps gaining new abilities we never see her develop.
That's enough.
From what I've seen, which hasn't been a whole lot, Azula isn't the same conniving, manipulative bully she was in the original, which doesn't change much at first glance, but when looked at more closely, that changes the entire dynamic between her and her friends Tylee and May. Azula was very much an abusive friend and sister in the original Avatar, even as a child having fun at the expense of her friends, but if Azula isn't that kind of character, what intimidates Tylee to help hunt for the Avatar? Do Tylee and May even help Azula if she isn't going to threaten them? Does this impact how Zuko and his friends are able to escape the Fire Nation prison? Because if May is helping Azula for no reason seemingly, then she has no real incentive to defy her and aid that escape. Fun fact, Princess Yue was never a waterbender, let alone an ice cream bender. You can look it up. I did. And why is she a furry? For what purpose did the creators find time in this rush show to change the character we will know for less than 2 episodes? Yeah, blah blah blah, the moon spirit helping her not die at infancy made her able to interact with the spirit world while dreaming? And for some reason that turns her into a weird three-tailed fox? When Aang brought Katara and Sokka through to the spirit world, they looked normal. So it really just looks like someone was trying to live out their Princess Yue fox girl fantasy.
I don't think we approached it with any idea like we had to do this or we had to do that. I mean, again, I was a fan of the show, so the most important thing for me was not a literal translation, but making sure we stayed true to what I felt was the spirit of the show.
Seriously, on a scale from respecting the source material to lighting that shit on fire after wiping your ass with it, I'd say that we're somewhere around wearing blindfolds and throwing darts at a board full of ideas the writers thought were cool. You would f*** it. Let's make Toph be able to see. Let's respect the hell out of that original story.
Truth is, I haven't mastered any other bending. But that's why I came here.
It would have been wise to have focused on your training during your journey.
Absolutely agreed, Paku. Aang should have already started being taught water since he is such a truly gifted bender in his presence.
That's a mark of a skilled bender.
It's almost like the director who is in charge of shooting this episode is really pissed at the directors who did episodes 1 through 6 for doing jack. And apparently, for some ungodly reason, Aang didn't get the memo from Kiyoshi back in episode 2 that the situation determines what is asked of the Avatar. Because even though he's had no issue using Force to protect his friends and himself from the Fire Nation, he's still talking about how he doesn't want to hurt anyone.
Spearhead an attack.
Actually, airbending is primarily a defensive discipline. Our style is to evade and avoid conflict.
And we aren't even close to being done. Remember that Aang must be meditating at a shrine to interact and talk to previous avatars, and that was a rule that Avatar Kiyoshi allegedly told Aang. So why the f*** is Avatar Kurok talking to Aang right now, warning him about his knife, and how only his knife can harm spirits? And I swear to God, if you try to make up some fake excuse for this show, like, well, oh, he spent some time in the spirit world, so he has a much stronger bond with it, and shut the f*** up. It's a dumb rule that they didn't even care about enough to tell their dumb director friends about.
Which reminds me, when did we get to fight training? Excuse me? I think my basic forms are pretty good, but I could use help with accuracy and increasing power.
I'm sorry, but women don't fight.
We use our skills to heal, not to harm.
I don't want to just heal.
Healing is a noble and sacred tradition, the highest of callings. In the Northern Water Tribe, women aren't allowed to fight.
Aren't allowed? That's not right.
But that is our way.
This is the most passionate I have seen Katara be about anything that wasn't a boy or trying to take a horrible side in an argument with Sokka. Well, to be honest, this is just her taking a horrible side in an argument with some person she's never met before, so I guess it's not that much of a stretch in character. Katara is completely out of line for demanding to be taught offensive moves that goes against their cultural beliefs. She can be upset that they deny teaching her more in-depth offensive attacks, but it's completely in the right to refuse what go against their traditions or way of life. Not only does this gutted character that we call Katara, who happens to stumble upon a backbone to argue over something she's completely wrong about with a stranger, make me nauseous. It's a familiar situation where the directors feel conflicted on where they want to take a character. Directors on episodes 1 through 6 seem to care more about Sokka's romance than making sure that there was an introduction between the main character and her, let alone flesh her out. And now they need Katara from the animated show for once, and there was no prerequisite for that character even existing in the Netflix adaptation. So everything involving this conflict between Katara and the Northern Water Tribe's beliefs will continue to make me till I no longer remember it.
Where will I be stationed during the battle?
Women aren't allowed in combat. I thought you knew.
No, I didn't. I wouldn't have accepted it if I did.
It's not a matter of accepting anything. It's how things are done.
It's stupid and it's wrong.
This is not up for debate.
I've been fighting firebenders ever since I left home. Can any of your men say that?
That doesn't matter.
Why not?
Because this isn't about them. It's about you. You haven't been training and preparing to lay down your life for everyone here. And I'm not going to let what happened to the Southern Tribe here.
I mean, it's not as if they can stop Katara from participating and helping defend off Fire Nation attacks. There's a possibility that if you showed what you're capable of instead of going,
it's stupid and it's wrong,
they'd have a better reason to make an exception to train you. They took what was originally a valid and meaningful conflict for equal treatment, and in their goal to modernize and adapt, the moral of it isn't only lost, but Katara looks like the instead of Paku. Because not only is she doing this, she's doing this with the knowledge that the Fire Nation army could be attacking at any minute.
You're not strong enough. Women aren't strong enough.
Why is Paku allowed to be sexist but not Sokka? If sexism really has no place in the series like the showrunner said, then why does it exist within Paku? Yes, he's supposed to resemble an old guy stuck in his ways, but the Southern Water Tribe was, I believe, the same way back before Sokka was left in charge, and Sokka most likely learned to think similarly from his father in the way that women aren't meant to be soldiers fighting on the front lines. There's even evidence of this with how he reacts to seeing not only female warriors, but female warriors just as capable, if not more so, than him. So again, why make such a big deal out of it and change a large portion of a character arc involving Sokka when it's clearly brought up either way?
Maybe it's better if you didn't fight. This battle, it'll be like nothing we've ever faced before. People are gonna get hurt and die.
Aang hasn't taken a single thing that any of the previous avatars have said to heart. He didn't listen to Kyoshi about being a mighty merciless warrior. He's yet to attempt Roku's advice at being a diplomat and trying to resolve this war peacefully. So why does what Kurok said about Aang's friends and what's best for them actually get to him?
Go kick his ass.
You serious?
Oh my god, let me get started. So first off, we get Katara, who attacks the waterbending master and hopes to provoke him into fighting her, which works. Then we get Katara fighting in ways we didn't even know, and frankly no reason she should know, like hand-to-hand combat. And we have this moment where Aang wants to break up the fight because Katara is kind of being a jerk, and Sokka stops him and is all like, nah man, maybe Paku can bend some sense into her. After that, Katara throws a few ice spears at Paku's face, which he counters with a
"How it feels to chew 5 gum. Stimulate your senses."
Katara then has this completely valid badass woman moment after Paku asks her,
"Had enough?"
And she responds with her own question of,
"Is that all you got?"
Then we get some Frozone meets Elsa type where Katara starts skating on ice she's forming in front of her. Finally, Paku says she doesn't suck that bad at waterbending, but because you still can't comprehend there are traditions and sacred ways of doing things that myself and the people of this kingdom hold dear, that as well as your inability to listen to order, your blatant disrespect to our culture and beliefs, and finally because you bend water like a girl are all the reasons why I won't let you participate in battle. The scene is as hollow as the rest of the show, with how Katara has never shown any defiance or stubbornness to anyone except maybe Sokka. So her rebellion against the ways of not just one stranger, but a whole kingdom's way of life is ridiculously out of character from that sad, melodramatic, argumentative sister we have seen. There's little training ever shown, the majority of it consisting of Katara dealing with her mom's death for the umpteenth time and finding reasons to not start Aang's waterbending training. The majority of what she knows is from her teaching herself, half of which we apparently don't see because each time she fights someone new, she's capable of new things. things. She's never been shown to be upset about the fairness between men and women before. In fact, when Sokka remarked how she should spend less time learning to waterbend putting the village at risk, she says, "Not everything is about preparing to fight," which ironically is all that she is interested in at this point. I have literally gone to urgent care because of this dumb forced conflict and dialogue.
I've been fighting firebenders ever since I left home. Can any of your men say that?
Tara hasn't even been fighting the Fire Nation since she left home. Team Avatar has been running from the Fire Nation since they left home. The only time it was vice versa was Omashu, and they still chased you even then.
I don't know if I can protect you. You can't.
What do you mean he can't protect you? That's the other half of your character gimmick, is after you're done thinking about how your mom died, Aang swoops in and saves you. From Zuko? From Zuko again? From Admiral Zhao? From Ko? For f**k's sake.
Kuro, Kuroku, Kyoshi, they all said that I need to do this by myself. The Avatar must bear the burden alone.
This is the past. The only one person can tell you the future. The person who will write the legend of Aang.
Thank God that's over. Alright, last episode of season one, let's see it.
Now is not the time, Katara.
Now is exactly the time.
I thought I made myself clear. Women are not allowed to talk.
I thought I showed you how stupid that is.
This again.
Yep, right in the middle of a Fire Nation siege. Let's hear it.
Forget your pride. This is about the survival of the waterbenders, and you need all the help you can get. You know we can make a difference.
We?
And this is where they took Katara's character from a logical and intelligent and ignorantly altruistic to insanely moronic. 1. Paku's culture has nothing to do with pride. It's a system developed over millennia that has proven to stand the test of time as well as an all-out war of the elements. 2. We send all of our women who were never trained, have never experienced firsthand what war against the Fire Nation is like, to the front lines to face off against soldiers who char others alive for fun. Who will be there to heal the mortally wounded? Who will be there in case there needs to be an evacuation? 3. How did you organize this tightly grouped squadron of women already be hit by one big precise trebuchet in such short amount of time? Tara not asking for permission to fight is fine. Her body, her choice, whatever. Throw yourself at a fireball. But she went from wanting validation for herself to fight to every able female waterbender. So the countless bombarded buildings that will be destroyed with children inside will have nobody to come to their rescue.
What good is it relying on the past when it stops us from having a future?
What is the point of the past? Hasn't the Fire Nation been at war with every other nation for a century? So assumingly Paku has kept the Northern Water Kingdom safe for at least decades, right? Remarkably, the only thing that'll stop them from having a future are all of these brainwashed women thinking that physically defending and fighting off the firebenders means less than, I don't know, maybe actually protecting the children? The literal future of the Water Tribe? This chick who was arguing with Katara 10 minutes ago has now completely changed her mind and is spouting nonsense, and unfortunately, Paku appeases them. No, this isn't the end of it. Stupid dumb Kuroku, who is talking to Aang outside of the shrine, which goes against the stupid dumb rules about his stupid dumb MacGuffin knife that is apparently the only thing able to kill the stupid dumb moon spirit that already chooses to be a stupid dumb vulnerable mortal one day of the year. So why did we invent a knife that is capable of killing spirits if the spirits are already mortal during that one day of the year? That seems redundant and a waste of time, and I think I hate this show. Moving on.
As long as he bows. Before Zhao, the Moon Slayer!
Please repeatedly bash my head in with a stone. Thank Christ who made the Katara Wants to Be Taught by Paku story and turned it into some woke dog sh** remixed version where Katara calls the Northern Water Kingdom's traditions
stupid and it's wrong.
She wants verbal consent to go fend off the Fire Nation, which is something you don't really need. Even worse than involves the women healers that are vital essential parts of defending against the invasion who themselves knew how valuable they were. Turning this into some grotesque, disgusting wet dream for social justice warriors where the message is women can fight against Fire Nation soldiers just as good as men, with every piece of evidence showing the contrary. Not only does this disgraceful adaptation spew nonsensical conflicts that make our main characters look ignorant and highly moronic, the direct changes they made to make the show more progressive are the exact things that created the canyon-sized imprudent inconsistencies that riddle the show with story issues. As an example, there was a decision to not make any attempt for Aang to learn waterbending this season.
I haven't learned any of the other bending skills, and I'll probably continue messing up.
Which led to an issue with even if they did write Katara to have shown some jealous tendencies, there's no feasible way to have Katara be jealous of Aang since he won't be taught by Paku. Which then leads to fabricating a conflict where she disagrees with their cultural choice of not allowing women to fight in a battle in an attempt to achieve the same essence that the original did. Which leads to the issue of Katara not showing any prior grievances with the societal responsibility differences between men and women, as well as the numerous times Katara claims these societal restrictions on women are due to Paku's pride or his narrow-mindedness, when in reality they are traditions passed down purposefully, providing a different type of responsibility to the women than to the men, but a responsibility with nonetheless value. The fact that although Paku was the Northern Water Kingdom's waterbending master and waterbending teacher, he was not the war general in charge of making decisions as who may or who may not participate, and that Katara, instead of helping in how she is asked, attempts to ratify her way of thinking over the entire Northern Water Kingdom, challenging the residential waterbending master in a duel in an attempt to change his mind, and strongly alter the method of defense, sending dozens of women who we have no reason to believe are as capable in defending themselves against Fire Nation soldiers as Katara to the front lines, all with the knowledge that the Fire Nation could be here at any moment. Now attempt to keep that all in mind with the fact that all these women who are never even trained to fight with their bending no longer have their bending to defend themselves. So they're just dead, all of them. We made this entire situation just for some agenda-pushing gender fairness, and it led to dozens of women dying because of it. Wonderful. Thanks.
Master Katara.
I almost jumped over and forgot the most important thing that happens in the season finale. Momo almost dies. Yeah, I kind of forgot he was even in the show, to be honest, because if they don't have time for Katara's character, I doubt they'll have time for a lemur. But this brings up an excellent thought. If Princess Waterbending Fox Yue is healing Momo with the aid of the Moon Spirit, and a part of the Moon Spirit's life now resides within Momo, could Sokka not just throw Momo into the Koi Pond instead of having Yue give up her life to save the Moon Spirit? Princess Yue's life has to be more valuable than Momo's, right? He is just a lemur, right? Yeah, and Aang decides to merge with Ocean Spirit, and we get a cool-looking, expensive CGI scene that mostly just pisses me off, because if the writing and story adaptation changes for the show weren't so unbearable, we could possibly have a really good show. Example. We have this scene as Aang is entering the Avatar state to go Godzilla mode, and Yue warns Aang that he will...
You'll be lost forever.
Which Aang responds with...
I should have been lost 100 years ago. This isn't my time or my world. I can save my world. I can save this one.
And for some reason later on, after he's rampaging and Yue gives up her life, Katara, who is not even conscious when Aang says this, somehow knows what he said about how he feels with this not being his world and that he should have died 100 years ago. I'm just bringing this up because we don't really have any prior examples of Aang not thinking this is his world, or that he should have died that day. Yeah, he's bummed that he failed and vanished, but he never made any of these statements to the viewers, so to us, Katara is a psychic.
I know you think you don't belong in this world. You were never meant to die 100 years ago.
After Aang returns, Katara and him gape in awe at all the homes that were destroyed and lives lost, a large part due to Katara's masterful battle tactician proficiency. Aang gets sad and flies away. Zuko doesn't know what he wants to do anymore. Sokka talks to the grieving father, Princess Waterbending Fox Girl Yue, and Katara then meets up with Paku, who attributes a portion of their victory against the Fire Nation's assault to Katara opening his eyes, when in reality it was 99% Aang, the Ocean Spirit, and Yue's sacrifice. And just when you thought it couldn't get any worse, Katara remarks on how Aang still needs to learn waterbending, and Paku says,
"In that case, he couldn't have asked for a better master."
Katara, the in less than half a month self-taught master who lost you is going to train Aang? Great.
You're gonna learn waterbending, and I'm gonna make sure of that. And then earthbending.
Which means back to Umashu. So, anyone else hungry?
Why is everything always winter snowing?
Says the kid with the melon head.
Nothing sets the tone of the fest of a first season quite like the quippy jokes about food as thousands grieve the losses of their homes and families. I'm gonna make the prediction now and say that Aang won't learn any bending. He's just gonna go Avatar State against the Fire Lord. Or hey, maybe Azula will be the Fire Lord. Fire Lordess? Fire Mistress? Whatever. Sorry this video took so long, I got sick while recording it, which is why my voice sounds different throughout the video. This process was pretty painful because I'm such a big fan of the original Avatar Last Airbender series. So we'll make it, if this video gets to 100 likes, I'll cover season 2, and we'll see where this goes from there. Thank you for watching. If you liked it and want to see more, leave a like or a comment. Subscribe if you want to see more of this type of content, and this has been a Sadge Review.